Welcome back, Boils and Ghouls. Remember, if you enjoy these videos, do me a favor and hit that like button. Think about sharing these videos with your friends. And if you really enjoy what you see, make sure you Hulk smash that subscribe button. If you want to support the channel, you can use the links below in the description to pick up your very own Uncle Jerk's Comic Book Corner t-shirt as designed by the Canadian sensation himself, James Edward Clark. Every dollar goes to upgrading equipment and more source material for better and more comprehensive videos. But now, it is trivia time. If you grew up in the 1980s or 1990s and you read comics, then you probably read your same collection of floppies a million times before turning in desperation to the newspaper. Back in the day when things were only available on printed paper, you just kind of got what you got, and I couldn't always afford to go out and pick up another Spider-Man issue. Instead, I found myself immersed in conventional fare for the time, like Calvin and Hobbes and Garfield, but I always had a wandering eye, and I came across a strip that seemed different. No one had stickers of this strip in their window. There weren't even any anthropomorphic animals to make plushies out of. It seemed like the people who read this comic were in a special club. Like you were part of something unique when you caught on to it. To me as a kid, it wasn't just a name. The Far Side seemed like a real place. It seemed like the place where all the cool kids hung out, smoking cigarettes with T-Rexes. Where there were no rules and anything was possible in all the best senses of the word. There were other strips that looked better. Calvin and Hobbes is still absolutely gorgeous, and Bill Watterson is one of the most gifted cartoonists to have ever worked in the medium. Few other strips ever approached the level of absolute hilarity that Far Side did, though. I also always felt like Gary Larson's Far Side appeared to be a man with essentially the same amount of artistic talent as I did, who was very simply attacking paper with pen and ink because he had to get these ideas out of his head. Turns out, I wasn't alone. Following its syndication, it didn't take long for the quirky strip to catch on and become a worldwide phenomenon. The Far Side ruled the newspaper funnies for a decade and a half, spawning two animated specials and more merchandise than I could even begin to recount here, including the famous yearly calendars. With more than 40 million copies of the collected editions sold at this point in 2021, it's unquestionably become one of the most successful cartoon strips of all time. Between 1979 and 1995, Larson created more than 4,337 strips before abruptly calling it quits in January of 1995. I know we mostly talk about capes and cowls, but tonight we're going to talk about the history and evolution of the Far Side, its eccentric and reclusive creator, as well as its official retirement, and best of all, Larson's announcement in December of 2019 that it would be coming out of self-imposed exile to release new strips after 14 years. At least kind of. But we'll get to that. So for now, kick back, relax, and enjoy this tantalizingly tasty tidbit of tawdry trivia and a little video essay I like to call A Walk on the Far Side. Gary Larson was an avid artist as a child, constantly doodling and drawing, but as he got older, he got more and more into music. By the time he was in high school, Larson had all but completely abandoned art and was playing both guitar and banjo pretty seriously, with actual aspirations of being a professional musician. After graduating high school, Larson got a job at a local music shop and continued plugging away at his music career. In interviews years later, Larson will recall that music shops are, quote, where musicians go to die. During this period, Larson was increasingly more dependent on his paycheck from the music shop as his guitar and banjo gigs began to dry up. He was a consideration as the guitar player for a fairly well-established band, and he thought he had the job on the lock, but turns out he didn't. When he got passed over for the guitar gig and took a small vacation from the music shop, Larson was quickly forced to completely re-examine his life and what he was doing. He was, quote, miserable, and Larson knew it was time for a change. He just didn't know what that change was going to be yet. Gary Larson took a week's vacation from the music shop, and during that time, he found himself drawing once again for the first time in what felt like forever. It was also the first time he had been happy doing something in a long time, and he quickly decided that his weird drawings would be a great way to supplement his income, or, God willing, even let him quit the music store where he was so miserable. Working round the clock, Larson managed 6 finished single panel strips that week, but he hadn't actually found anyone to buy them yet. After a little bit of hustling, Gary Larson managed to sell all 6 strips to the Pacific Search for an astounding $90. But he realized early on, the more places that carried your strip, the better the pay for the same amount of work, and also sold these original 6 strips to the Summer News Review for $3 a pop, as well as parlayed their interest into a weekly strip he then called Nature's Way. Gary Larson knew instantly that he'd found his calling, but things didn't change for him overnight. If anything, they remained basically the same, except that he now had the added work of the strip on top of everything else. Despite the grind, Gary Larson stuck with the new profession. It wasn't paying the bills, but it was making him happy, and the music shop was not. Despite money problems, Larson was so totally burnt on the music store, he quit anyway, with the intention of making cartooning his full-time career. That didn't really pan out, and soon Larson found himself looking for another job to supplement his meager salary as a cartoonist. While in college, he originally pursued a biology degree, but decided instead on communications in the end, a decision he still regrets to this day, apparently. While he might not have pursued his biology degree, Gary Larson has always loved animals, and when he saw an opening, he decided to interview for a position as a local animal cruelty investigator. While he did get the job, apparently Gary Larson hit a dog on his way to the interview. The dog was fine, but Larson took it as an extremely bad omen, and though he took the job, he also redoubled his efforts to make his art his sole source of income during 1978 and 1979. In 1979, Larson saved up all his vacation time, and knowing that the limited income he was getting from the Pacific Search and the Summer News Review would never cut it, set out for San Francisco with a portfolio of work and the intention of not returning until he had sold the strip. He'd recently sold Nature's Way to the Seattle Times, finagled a raise in pay from $9 to $15 with them, and got his strip moved to a more prominent position directly next to a popular children's crossword puzzle. It finally seemed like things were looking up for Larson, and he hoped to turn this success into more success in San Francisco. But this move next to the crossword puzzle would have unintended consequences he would be completely unaware of until his return from San Francisco. On top of this, even with the pay increase and the added paper carrying Nature's Way, Larson knew there was absolutely no way to make a living off of what he was doing. Meanwhile, during this week vacation to San Francisco, to his amazement, Gary Larson managed to set up a meeting with Stan Arnold, the editor of the San Francisco Chronicle. Arnold immediately saw the promise in Larson's work, but he refused to run the strip as Nature's Way. Arnold told Larson the only way they would run the strip is if he changed the name to The Far Side. I looked high and low for an interview or even a quote from Arnold where he explained what the name meant, how he'd come up with it, or why he thought it was better than Nature's Way, but to absolutely no avail. You would think something like that would be something you would remember or would be asked about in an interview, but Larson has said repeatedly in interviews over the years that he legitimately did not care what the name of the strip was, just that he'd managed to sell the strip to a much larger paper with a lot more clout than anyone he'd been dealing with previously. In interviews years later, Larson would recall, quote, "They could have called it Revenge of the Zucchini People." During these initial meetings, Arnold apparently also pressed for another change, but this time Larson pushed back. Arnold tried to insist on the inclusion of a recurring or central character for people to latch onto and instantly know what strip they were reading. Gary Larson was vehemently opposed to the idea, and thankfully Arnold let that one go, apparently sated by Larson's easy acquiescence to the suggested name change. Returning home victorious, Larson was elated at first. He hadn't just managed to sell his strip, he was well on his way to living out his dream of being a professional cartoonist at this point. His work was now appearing in 4 papers and counting, with the tantalizing prospect of that number exponentially increasing thanks to his new deal with the San Francisco Chronicle. But things wouldn't be that easy, and there were still a few rough stumbling blocks in his way before Gary Larson would become a world-renowned artist and a household name only a few short years later. While Gary Larson had returned victorious from his latest battle selling his strip in San Francisco, he nearly lost the war. As it turns out, had it not been for Stan Arnold, not only would the strip not have been titled The Far Side, it would not have existed at all. When he got home from his vacation in San Francisco, Gary Larson was almost immediately contacted by the Seattle Times, who told him they were dropping his strip, apparently putting the offbeat and often somewhat morbid humor of Gary Larson's work next to a kid's crossword puzzle hadn't really set so well with some people. After copious complaints from readers, the Seattle Times had decided, while Larson was on vacation, that they wouldn't just move Nature's Way again, they were going to stop carrying the strip altogether. Larson has said in interviews for years that if he hadn't sold the strip to the San Francisco Chronicle, he would have simply given up and quit. It felt like in a lot of ways, for every step forward that he took, he was forced to take 2 steps back. He was working himself to death meeting constant deadlines, even by this point in 1979, and it didn't really seem to be getting him anywhere. Luckily for Larson, Arnold, who was extremely impressed with Larson's work and his work ethic, quickly began to push for the Far Side syndication. Gary Larson knew he was close to breaking in, being a real professional cartoonist, and he wasn't going to blow it. When the strip was eventually sold into syndication a few months later, Larson, realizing this was probably his only shot at his dream, threw himself into his work with even more fervor and conviction than ever before. According to Gary Larson, just to prove to Arnold and others carrying the strip that he was up to the task of meeting the rigorous deadlines required of nationally syndicated strips, Larson did 8 cartoons instead of 7 for the first 3 months. I know that might not sound like a lot, but you have to think that's not counting the rejected strips. And apparently, there were a lot of those in the early days. While Arnold was well aware of the Far Side's potential, he was also weary of publishing anything that didn't measure up to his stringent and rigorous standards. Arnold was reportedly so picky that he actually ended up rejecting 7 strips in a single week early on. With Larson doing 8 finished strips a week instead of 7, and having 7 more strips rejected in a single week, this means that at one point, Gary Larson actually did 15 fully completed strips in a single week. This time, though, his efforts would pay off in spades. Over the next few years, the Far Side was picked up by a ton of newspapers, but there was a problem. Initially, no one would stick with the strip. They would run the Far Side for a while and then cut the strip, only to then get it back due to reader request. This meant that while the actual number of papers carrying the Far Side was very healthy, the constant shifting initially made it difficult for the Far Side to find its following. Despite this, over the next 4 years, Larson's work attracted more and more attention, until finally, in 1984, he was approached by Chronicle Features, who would become Universal Press Syndicate, about collecting his work for the very first time. After signing with Universal Press, it was a fairly quick rise to the top for Gary Larson. By 1987, only 3 years later, he had sold more than 6 million copies of his collected Far Side material and managed to land 3 of those collections on the New York Times bestsellers list. With his newfound fame came money, and lots of it. Larson was super invested in his work and determined to make the Far Side better than ever before with his newfound income, and he was one of the first big cartoonists that I know of to integrate computer technology into his work. Gary Larson had never really been happy with his lettering, so in late 1986 or early 1987, Gary Larson bought an extremely expensive home computer system on which to letter the Far Side. Despite this, it doesn't really feel like Larson knew what to do with or even necessarily wanted the newfound money that was beginning to pour in, or the fame that was coming with his strip. While the computer lettering added a level of polish and refinement that the strip had never enjoyed, it did not help rough the edges of Gary Larson's humor. As Larson was becoming more prominent and papers all over the country were picking up the Far Side left and right, along with all the newfound fans, came tons of public outcry about how inappropriate the strip was. It's weird reading about the Far Side in hindsight, as really it's pretty innocuous, and retrospectively it's hard to see why there was all this uproar about the strip at the time. While strips designed to obviously simply sell merchandise like Garfield were definitely less offensive, this is because they literally weren't saying anything. Garfield was intentionally written not to be funny. It was literally a vehicle to sell people merchandise. But it's hard to toss stones when you look at the tumultuous field of cartooning in the 1980s. At the time the Far Side rose to prominence, it was somewhat of a dark age for newspaper strips and cartoonists in a lot of ways. Their audience was quickly shrinking throughout the 1980s due to Reagan's deregulation of children's programming, which in turn led to an absolute onslaught of programming like He-Man, G.I. Joe, and the Transformers that then had their own successful toy lines, most often comic book tie-ins as well. This trend would only continue to get worse as the decade marched on, and as a result, most strips were either absolutely flavorless, saccharine PC crap trying to fly under the radar of the watchful parent groups already completely riled up about what was happening on television, or they were attempts to market a character as effectively as possible in order to simply sell merchandise. Gary Larson, however, was not interested in such trappings, despite what it might look like looking back with the Far Side showing up on more and more merchandise as the 1980s marched on. And this was especially strange because Gary Larson was getting more and more difficult to find himself. As time passed, Gary Larson became more withdrawn and more reclusive. There's a single 2020 interview from 1986, along with a small handful of interviews that he did as the Far Side rose to prominence, but other than the introductions to his books, that's about it. As Gary Larson was seen less and less, the Far Side was seen more and more though, and it seems that this was no mistake, but rather a calculated move on Larson's end. I'm not sure he knew how to handle the immense success that he was experiencing or the fame that came with it, but he made some very interesting decisions, to say the least. As I mentioned, merchandise began to explode, and at a certain point in the late 1980s, Larson actually stopped even taking requests for licensing. For anyone who works in the field, it's a well-known fact that this is where the real money is. Not in the actual strip, but the merchandising rights. While most people would have been seduced by the promise of extremely easy money, Larson made a hard call and decided to stop licensing the Far Side out at the height of its popularity. You can say what you want about the guy, but Gary Larson has some serious integrity. The amount of money that he was passing on is almost mind-boggling. Larson has himself even jokingly referred to the early calendars as, quote, printing money. According to Larson, he was afraid that his creation would finally hit a point of critical mass, that it would actually become too omnipresent, and that people would start hating the Far Side as a result. As the Far Side continued to gain popularity year after year, the grind of working on the strip day in and day out began to get to Larson, and he was thrust unwillingly further and further into the public eye than ever before. Larson never seemed very aware of his growing status, and as such, never made much of an effort to hide himself very effectively, or in fact, at all, really. He was seemingly completely unprepared for his skyrocketing fame following the Far Side syndication in 1980, so much so that Larson was essentially dependent on his editor, his wife, who is also his art manager, and a few other employees to shield him from himself, his rabid fan base, and increasingly the outside world in general. Larson just had no idea how to deal with his growing celebrity status, and it was a problem. If you think I'm being overly dramatic, check out the 1987 Sun Sentinel interview. In the middle of one of his rare interviews, they're interrupted by a knock on Larson's front door. When he answers it, there are three random little girls perched on his doorstep who then proceed to espouse how much they love the Far Side and all ask for autographs, which Larson happily provided. It turns out his name and address were still in the phone book. If you team this level of unpreparedness with the fact that Gary Larson was quickly becoming an internationally recognized and highly sought after illustrator, you've got a recipe for disaster. As the years ticked by, Gary Larson's writing wasn't the only thing he was recognized for either, and his primitive drawings began to garner a lot of attention too. Larson was subsequently invited to host exhibits at innumerable prestigious galleries across the globe, and with each successive triumph, as the Far Side got just a little bit bigger, Larson withdrew just a little bit more into the shadows. By the time I was becoming really aware of cartoonists and was getting interested in learning about the actual people responsible for some of my favorite strips and illustrations, I was befuddled to find that there was basically nothing out there about Gary Larson. By 1991, finding an interview with him was a rarity. By 1993, it was impossible. There was nothing. The guy was a ghost. No pictures, no interviews, no nothing. It was bizarre to me as a child, but I got a rare glimpse inside the mind of the reclusive creator when I was lucky enough to see an exhibit of his original art with tons of annotated material at the Golden Gate Bridge Museum in San Francisco. It was only then, seeing a much fuller picture of what was happening with the Far Side, that I began to understand why Larson was feeling increasingly secondary to his own creation. He felt somewhat isolated and ignored, and he liked to think he preferred it that way. However, there has to be that little part of you that wants accolades, that wants attention. With his continued self-isolation, though, it was obvious that no one knew Gary Larson. people loved The Far Side, but they didn't even know Gary Larson. So how could they like him? He was quickly becoming the man behind the strip, but it was a self-fulfilling prophecy. In Larson's own words, he believed that cartoonists should be, quote, anonymous, completely secondary to their work, and he obviously took great pains to make sure that was the case with The Far Side. While this might be a recipe for better success with your strips, it's not going to do wonders for a human being's psyche. Larson was essentially voluntarily working on something for decades in near utter obscurity. While Bill Watterson has taken much the same approach, I've never gotten the feeling that Watterson is as conflicted or affected by his decision as Gary Larson. Regardless, the more ravenously that people sought out Larson, the further he withdrew into his seclusion. The farther he withdrew, the more he felt like people were unable to see the man behind the creation. But all of this was secondary to an all too overlooked and perhaps the most important part of commercial illustration, the daily grind. He was locked in what must have felt like a never-ending cycle of work, and he wanted off the ride. Gary Larson was done. I don't know if he gave his editors or his publishers much more of a heads up, but I do know that the announcement on January 1st of 1995 saying that he was ceasing publication of The Far Side and retiring from cartoons came out of nowhere for me and a lot of other fans. Larson apologized to his fans for retiring, but said that he didn't want the strip to get boring. Larson was ever mindful of other strips that had long overstayed their dues and been relegated to obscurity as time passed due to the faltering quality of the publication. In the same way that he feared over-merchandising the strip would result in people coming to hate The Far Side, he feared his writing, which he felt was getting, quote, repetitive, would likewise sour people on the strip and eventually destroy its legacy. While I was absolutely devastated at the time by the announcement, looking back, I think it's one of the gutsiest and bravest decisions that an illustrator could have made. Gary Larson didn't want to compromise the quality of his work with an inability to let go of the past or an inability to change and evolve while trapped in what seemed to be a never-ending cycle of work. Gary Larson was so absolutely finished with drawing that he said when he retired from The Far Side, he was in essence retiring from drawing and didn't think that he would ever draw, at least professionally, ever again. True to his word, Gary Larson effectively hung up his pen and pencil. He did do a single illustrated children's book, There's a Hair in My Worm, in 1998, but it wasn't exactly the triumphant return that people so badly desired. Most people agreed that while the illustrations were definitely top-notch, it felt like Larson had lost his edge, and a lot of people pointed out he seemed out of touch with what both kids and adults wanted to read. The book was a New York Times bestseller in 1998 regardless, but it seems that Larson either took heed of the lackluster response from longtime Far Side stalwarts longing for him to be lured out of retirement, or children who didn't really know who he was and did not get the book. Widely forgotten today, the book would mark Larson's final foray into professional illustration, with one exception several years later. Following There's a Hair in My Worm, Larson did a single cover illustration for The New Yorker in 2003. Aside from The New Yorker cover, though, Larson has continuously refused any other commercial work of any sort that I am aware of. In fact, according to Gary Larson, he enjoyed not drawing so much after years of The Far Side that the only illustrations he did were for the family Christmas card that he did every year. The years passed on and his pen sat unused in growing states of disrepair, patiently waiting between their periodical yearly December dust-off. For anyone who doesn't use real ink pens, they dry out. There's a well that feeds the liquid ink into the nib and lets you write. But if you let the ink dry in it, it can be a real pain to get all of that old dried ink out of the well and clean up the nib. As the pen sat for longer and longer, more than a decade, Larson had to fight with them more and more with each successive year to get them to work. Sometime around 2015 or 2016, Larson, exasperated in his yearly battle with his pens, remembered that he'd been gifted a drawing tablet some years before as a Christmas present by a close friend. Annoyed with his pens and still wanting to draw his yearly Christmas card, Larson decided to dust off the device and began to experiment. Now, this is a rather interesting twist, as Larson had gone full-on Lars Ulrich in 1999. I'm not making fun of Larson, I love the guy's work, but it just feels like he was totally out of touch with reality by the late 1990s. As the internet took off and people began posting his Far Side cartoons on their websites, Larson got increasingly irritated by what he saw as piracy and bootlegging. He began aggressively pursuing cease and desist orders, which he wrote himself. If anyone is old enough to remember the backlash on Metallica, and Lars Ulrich in particular, about the Napster debacle, then you have an inkling of what people were saying about Gary Larson. Despite his better intentions, Gary Larson was officially becoming known as the old man yelling at the neighborhood kids to keep off of his lawn. And Larson wasn't out performing in sold-out arenas, or even putting out new material for that matter. He was just the mysterious guy who had done those weird Far Side cartoons that your parents read and then apparently locked himself away in his tower like the Onceler. Also, if you recall, Lars Ulrich kind of took the hint, learned a little bit about what he was contending with, and made the wise decision to not only back down, but to basically drop the subject entirely and all but apologize for even saying anything about people bootlegging his music to begin with. Gary Larson did not. As late as 2009, I know of small, I mean like tiny blogs and other sites getting cease and desist orders directly from Larson's Farworks Incorporated. An unfortunate result of his continued reclusive nature was that I legitimately don't think Larson was exposed to the internet much, and as a result, didn't really understand how it worked. He was so concerned and so upset by people sharing his work without permission that Larson personally penned the cease and desist letter that Farworks was serving people with. That's insane. As more and more people were hit with cease and desist orders, many people, fans included, responded by countering with the fact there was no official Far Side website. In fact, Gary Larson did not even have a personal page. While he ordered the takedown of his work en masse, he wasn't offering fans any legitimate alternative means with which to see his work on the internet in return. When he did eventually launch a site, nearly a decade later, he not only went out of his way to include a note repeating much of the same verbiage from his personally penned cease and desist letter, but a continued demand that Far Side material never be shared on the internet ever for any reason by anyone other than him. The letter itself is pretty interesting and puts things much more into perspective. He makes the bizarre analogy that his comics are his, quote, children, and he, quote, worries where they go at night without telling him. I mean, I get what he's saying. I know what he means. I'm an artist, not an idiot. But to see this all concisely thought out and well written is just bizarre, and I'll be honest, feels like a stupid waste of time and energy, in my opinion. asking people to not repost your material is like begging people to repost your stuff. Again, I think this attests to just how out of touch Larson has been for so very long. But for the record, this is the reason that you have not seen a single Far Side cartoon in its entirety in this video. I've chosen only to show small bits and sections to illustrate what I'm talking about for informational and historical purposes. But I have endeared to respect Gary Larson's wishes for his work to not be shared on the internet in any way, shape, or form, despite the fact I find it all to be extremely ludicrous, to say the least. As I said, I respect the guy's work, it just feels like he's totally out of touch, and I often wonder what's going through his head when he makes decisions like posting this open letter to his website. Gary Larson's continued disconnection with the rest of the world, especially technologically, is what makes the final wrinkle in this story all the more interesting. Remember how I was talking about that drawing tablet someone gifted him? Well, it turns out that when he started using it, he liked it. He liked it a lot. He liked it so much that after more than 2 decades, he actually started drawing again. Gary Larson was experimenting and learning, and for the first time in a long time, Larson felt like he was growing as an artist again. For the first time, he seemed to be trying to embrace the digital format and even started a Far Side website in 2019. Granted, most people weren't paying attention by that point. To be fair, it had been more than 20 years since Larson called it quits, and most fans had read every Far Side a million times and knew from his sporadic but repeated statements that Larson wasn't going to be coming out of retirement anytime soon. But then, in July of 2019, Larson shocked the world by doing just that, announcing he would be coming out of retirement. At least kind of. While Larson refuses to get back into the daily grind required to produce a daily strip, which I can't blame him for, he shared in an open letter on the official Far Side website that he was enjoying a renewed interest in art thanks to the drawing tablet he had been gifted and had been so inspired by it that he'd produced his first work in more than 25 years. If this wasn't enough to have most Far Side fans, and especially those of us who had researched Gary Larson and knew a little bit about him, scratching our heads, Larson followed this by what I can only describe as a decision completely out of left field. He announced he had no interest in publishing his new material and he wasn't going to be holding himself to any kind of schedule, just kind of drawing when the mood struck, but that he would be sharing that material for free on his website. When I first saw the announcement a few months back, I knew I had to be reading something wrong. Gary Larson wasn't getting dragged out of retirement come hell or high water, and he wasn't sharing his stuff on the internet exclusively. If time has shown anything, it's that he and Bill Watterson aren't going to do anything they don't darn well please, and it doesn't seem like they want to be doing much of anything, at least not in the public eye. Despite my reservations of the validity of the article's claim, my curiosity piqued. I started poking around and lo and behold, it was true. Larson had put up his first 2 cartoons in 2.5 decades several months before to much less acclaim or recognition than I would have guessed. I was floored. I thought maybe, just maybe, he was starting to catch on this internet stuff and use it to his advantage, expose an entirely new generation who doesn't read books or newspapers or magazines to his work. But after some research and several months of observing his online presence, I don't really know if this is necessarily true though. When I originally started working on this piece, there were only 2 available strips in the news section of Larson's official site, his first creations in 2.5 decades. They were proudly and prominently displayed with the promise of more work to come when Larson felt the urge to draw. As of the completion of this video, there are 5 strips up, but they're not the same ones that were there before, and the other two appear to have vanished. Larson doesn't appear to be cataloging or archiving the material that he's posting either. While usually this might not be extremely problematic, I assume the existing strips are simply replaced when Larson is struck by inspiration and has new pieces or a new piece to post. By his own admission, his schedule is erratic at best, and this means that there's no way of telling how long a strip will be featured on the site or when it will be taken down. In essence, I get the feeling he expects fans to check that section almost daily in hopes of new material, only to be rewarded every few months. Normally, I wouldn't give this a second thought, really, but Gary Larson isn't hurting for money. His Far Side collection, The Complete Far Side, was the most expensive book to ever reach the New York Times bestsellers list, retailing at a whopping $125, and he said that he could live comfortably simply off of the sales from the yearly Far Side calendars. Because of all of this, I doubt we see a collection or a publication of this new material anytime soon, if ever during Larson's lifetime, which is a real shame. It feels like this whole announcement should have been met with a lot more excitement. I honestly don't think that a lot of adults who read The Far Side in the paper and became ravenous fans even know that this is happening. Their kids aren't fired up about The Far Side like the previous generation, and it really feels like Larson might have just missed both the point and the boat. Their parents are too old and busy with real life crap to notice or maybe even care at this point that The Far Side is back, and because Larson spent so many years dedicated to erasing The Far Side's digital footprint from the pixels of your computer screens, younger kids often don't even know what the strip is. I know that in an era of quickly disappearing physical media, it's hard to justify publishing anything, and that he is in retirement. This stuff is only for fun. He's under no obligation to do the work or to share it with anyone, and especially not for free. But it seems like if you're going to go through all the trouble of locking your images so that people can't save them, and trust me, his site had to have been expensive to design and done by some decent programmers, because it was exceedingly hard to pop out any of the images posted to his site without using methods short of third-party applications. Not that I would ever dare to do such a thing as to catalog these cartoons and strips, which may very likely disappear into digital ether, never to be seen again. But if you refer to your strips as your children, I would want what was best for my kids, my strip. I would want people to see it, to enjoy it, to learn and grow and evolve through the interaction of people with my kids. That's what cartooning is all about, isn't it? Making people laugh or think or cry, to impact someone in some lasting way that they might not even understand in a deftly simple swoop of the pen. Or has that all been drained from Gary Larson, navigating his way through a sea of sharks and rising to become one of the world's most prominent and reclusive cartoonists? Is there nothing left but the fear and loathing of waiting to be taken advantage of or ignored? Because a lot of times I get the feeling it's much more a case of the latter, and that makes me profoundly sad to think about. Don't get me wrong. I'll take what I can get. I'm happy there's new Gary Larson material, and I'm even more excited for Larson, who seems like he's finally found the joy of drawing once more after all these years after having it taken away from him. It's just, I would think you would want to share that and make it available to fans and people who have supported you and continue to support you through decades of retirement. What do you think? Is Larson just being reclusive and eclectic and weird? Or do you think that he's making some sort of statement by only making the material available for a little while, like it would have been when originally published in the newspaper? Is he just completely out of touch with reality? Or is he somehow talking about the former disposable nature of comics and comic strips and his own aversion to merchandising and marketing and the entire capitalist side of commercial art? I could actually respect and kind of get behind that, but he's so enigmatic and so reclusive, I just don't know what to make of it or him at this point. Get in the comments section below and let me know what you think. Did you even know Gary Larson was doing new strips? Did you or do you care? Whatever the case may be, while I might not be able to pin down his exact motives, I for one am happy to be seeing new material from the master and have been really enjoying the stuff he's been putting up. Speaking of which, I hope you liked this walk on the far side. I know it was a little bit different, but I hope you enjoyed anyways, maybe even learned something. If you did like what you saw, hit that like button, get in the comment section below and let me know. Think about sharing these videos with your friends, and if you really enjoyed what you saw, make sure you Hulk smash that subscribe button. If you do that, make sure you ding the little notification bell so you keep up with these doses of trivia that I'm always dropping. If you feel like you're in a position to help the channel grow, shirts are now available. There's a link in the description below to those, as well as a ton of other merch in case you're interested. Thanks to everyone who's already ordered and for sticking with me. Again, I hope you all enjoyed, maybe even learned something. And as always, I really, truly, and honestly ask only two things. Keep hitting those local shops and keep reading comics.